in case we do get flooding.
Thanks, Mark. Good afternoon. Just to reiterate what we talked about yesterday, we have worked with our state partners. We have looped around with all of our municipalities with regards to what their potential needs might be. We've had a few requests for pre-positioning. We do, thanks to our partners from the state, have a significant stockpile that's at the ready at any given time for items such as pumps and hoses and generators that we might need. So those municipalities out there that have traditional flood areas that might have been concerned, every locality knows their issues better than most of us that are at the 50,000 foot level. So that's why we always make a point of reaching out to them to get those things done. So there are a couple of municipalities that will have some pre-deployed. There are others that know exactly what our resources are and what the capabilities of the state are. State's at the ready, we're at the ready. Hopefully the towns and the villages will get to us as quickly as possible if they do not want things pre-deployed. So we continue to work that. We continue to work, obviously, a number of operations out here at the Emergency Operations Center with the National Guard, with our state assets, also with some of our local mutual aids that have come in. And we have mutual aids that have come in from across the state that are here and have been deployed out and about, including, I just wanted to touch base again, thank you to the EMS Task Force that has been up until recently running almost exclusively the EMS in the city of Buffalo, assisting Buffalo Fire to get to those areas that they need to get to. And those resources have come from local, and they've also come from across the state. So this has truly been a team effort. We have a little slogan when people come here to work with us. We leave our badges that are on the sides of our shirts at the door. We all work together, and in the end, we've got some pretty tasty sausage that comes out of this whole thing here. It's very productive. It's just a matter of getting everybody working on the same page, and we appreciate that.
Thank you, Dan. Our Department of Public Works, of course, they have not been stopping since, well, they didn't, everyone stopped at one point, I have to say, when we had to bring in our crews, but they were pre-salting before the first snowflake hit, and they are still out there helping to clean up in the city of Buffalo and do cleanup in other areas where they have very high snow banks. We have actually, on a preliminary estimate, the few days of storm we have, what's today, Thursday?
Yeah.
It's Thursday, snow started Friday, so basically we're 7 days. The preliminary estimate that Erie County has incurred $5 million worth of costs just on our independent county contractors that we hired to assist, of which $1 million of it was spent just yesterday alone, all in the city of Buffalo. It is incredible. We are responsible for gas for all these large, diesel, I should say, for all of these large entities, these trucks that are coming in. And we're spending, not spending, but we're using about 2,000 gallons of diesel every 4 hours. So it is an incredible effort that's been done by the Department of Public Works and our partners. And it continues because there's still more work to do, including cleaning in the city of Buffalo, parts of Cheektowaga. And I'm going to turn it over to our Commissioner of Public Works, Bill Gary, to give a little bit more of a discussion on that.
Thanks, Scott, Executive. Good afternoon. Again, today we're back at it with the 24-hour operations within the city limits from the Clinton Broadway area south through the First Ward, South Buffalo. We have 72 loaders and 119 dump trucks down there, along with some National Guard assets helping us maintain a safe passage for not just the pedestrians and vehicles now that the travel ban's been lifted, but also for our contractors in that area. They will be continuing this effort through tonight. We're into the second pass. Some places were two plus. We're trying to define the scope and limitations for the contractors so that we can green up some of the roads through the city. We've been in contact this morning, multiple phone calls with not just the Department of Public Works in the city, but also our contractors, so that we're all on the same page. We did anticipate traffic being heavy today, so the operation has slowed down a little. But I think just a little background information on those 72 loaders and 119 dump trucks. We contract with Union Concrete and Bob and Gary Hill there, and Mike Salvador and his daughter, Jenna, through CATCO. They have almost 40 contractors working underneath them. Most of these are competitors, but through this whole event, it's been one force, one team, and it's no different than the Public Works and all the local municipalities, towns, cities, and villages, Lackawanna, Clarence, and Grand Island. Everybody's been a tremendous effort through this. There's been an outpouring of other mutual aid assets coming in from across the state, and they're within the city right now, And again, by tomorrow, hopefully with the warmer weathers, the slower melt, it's manageable. We're not really too concerned with any flooding, although some of our districts right now are doing some snow ditching, opening up drainage inlets so that this gradual melt will take place. And we're going to see some localized little ponding areas, but hopefully that's it and everyone gets a good break this weekend, gets to enjoy the nice weather.
Thank you, William. Towed vehicles, we are down to 40 vehicles in all of the county lots that you may see on our website at erie.gov/towed vehicles. There will come a point where if the vehicles are not picked up, we will have to take them out of those sites. So we're requesting you to pick them up. If your car is damaged and you can't drive it, we are requesting that you come with a wrecker so that they can take it out of there and you can take it to your auto shop and have it fixed. A baby formula. This is something that we announced last night. There is a baby formula shortage locally as deliveries could not be made. I want to thank Wegmans for donating thousands of dollars worth of formula that the members of the Erie County Sheriff's Office drove 6 hours to Pottsville, Pennsylvania, to a distribution center there to pick it up. If you are in dire need of formula, just don't try to take some if you don't need it, but if you're in dire need of formula, please call our 716-858-SNOW number, S-N-O-W, that's 7669, to request some. So 716-858-SNOW. However, I want to note the SNOW number will shut down as of 7 p.m. tonight. So we put out a request earlier. We had a lot of requests. We had some calls come in. So if you need baby formula in a dire position, we have both dry and liquid as donated by Wegmans. Once again, thank you to the Wegmans family for doing that. Please call us at 716-858-SNOW to request some, which will be delivered by Erie County Sheriff's deputies. I want to turn it over to our Undersheriff, William Cooley. Thank the Sheriff's Department as well as Chief Brian Brizzolero once again for all their work, incredible work. I mean, everything from going to pick up baby formula in Pottsville, Pennsylvania, which is 6 hours away, to, of course, being on the roads during the height of this. Done it all. So thank you to the members of our Erie County Sheriff's Office and all law enforcement that have worked very hard during these days. With that, I turn it over to Undersheriff.
Thank you, sir. Good afternoon. The immediacy of our response to this storm has passed, and we're going to continue to staff the EOC here as long as it's appropriate to do so. Our supervisors have done a real a good job down here of directing our workforce to ensure that things are getting done and getting done right. I want to express our condolences to everyone that was adversely affected by this storm, especially those who lost loved ones. It's extremely difficult. And you're in our thoughts and prayers. I also want to recognize the hard work of all the people that we teamed up with, all the essential workers that we teamed up with during this event. It's really been quite an experience, and it's been gratifying to work with all these hardworking men and women. And also the commitment that we've seen out of the Erie County Sheriff's personnel in the Jail Management Division, in the Dispatch Division, in our Police Services Division. It's inspiring. Our aviation unit is truly a regional asset, as they demonstrated again, going up and providing just excellent intelligence for everyone that's involved in this cleanup. Going forward, we're going to evaluate our actions and our equipment to see what was done well and where we can improve. And that's being done in earnest actually as we speak. Unfortunately, there are many tragic stories and some inspiring stories that are going to emanate from the storm. And, in the end, we get through it, and perhaps 2023 won't be as challenging as 2022. Thank you.
Thank you, Undersheriff. We have to hope that 2023 is better than 2022. We started with still responding to COVID. We had the horrible, of course, mass shooting at the Tops on May 14th. We had, of course, a major snowstorm 4 or 5 weeks ago that dumped 7 feet of snow, and now this blizzard. We will begin reducing much of the non-snow removal response in the next 24 hours. Just give you an example. For your example, yesterday, our county dialysis transport teams made 77 runs. Today is 2. Yesterday, they made 10 medication runs. Today, 110 medication runs yesterday. Today is 15, and there were even more the day before. The National Guard has nearly completed its welfare checks, as well as the joint task force from EMS. So they've gone around to many houses, hundreds and hundreds of houses, to determine if people are okay. We're also calling individuals through our 858 snow line who requested assistance. We're calling them back to make certain they're okay, which makes it easier because then we don't have to send the guard to the house if they say they're okay. The National Guard will continue to provide traffic control to ensure the streets are as the work is being cleared, are safe. There is gigantic equipment that normally you'd never see on a road. You'd see in a quarry, but you wouldn't see on a road. And we just have to make certain that we don't have any tragic incidences of people getting hit in cars or pedestrians getting struck. So thank you to the National Guard for your incredible efforts. Major from the National Guard, Schmiegel, has been here since, basically it never seems he leaves. I give him credit. He's here all the time at our Emergency Operations Center. I believe him and his members of his team are actually sleeping in one of our ancillary buildings outside here on cots and have been. And I just want to thank every one of the members of the National Guard for all that they did to help us get through this tragic blizzard. As of 7 p.m. tonight, we will begin to demobilize the Emergency Operations Center. The actual deactivation of our work in the Operations Center, as well as the lifting of the state of emergency, will still take some time. We are not in a position where we can lift it at this point because there's still a lot of work that has to be done. But we will start demobilizing it, which means we won't have as many people here from all of the agencies. As these agencies complete their work, we can send them back. And it's not just county agencies. Of course, New York State is here. I also want to thank our friends in the city of Buffalo from Buffalo Fire and Buffalo Police. They've been here, as well as Buffalo DPW. We've talked to their staff members personally, including a lot in the last few days, as they've been here at our Emergency Operations Center, helping to communicate information to us. This has been an unprecedented event. I want to thank everyone, especially our first responders, law enforcement, public works, other public employees, National Guard, the 911 call takers, and especially the entire community for your response to this unprecedented blizzard. Earlier today, I had an opportunity to address the men and women in the main operations center at the Emergency Operations Center here. Yeah, I should say at the operations room, in which there was a changeover. It was a changeover from the overnight crowd that worked from 7 p.m. to 7 a.m. this morning, and those that were coming in at 7 a.m. So it was fully packed with people. And it has been a privilege, the privilege of my life, truthfully, to serve with these people, an honor, and for me to play one small role while they were working an incredible amount to save lives. And that's what I want to focus on as I end today before we take questions. We are going to focus, and we often do it, on the worst of a situation. And what we need to remember, and what I'm going to take from this experience, in addition to lessons that will be learned, is I'm going to focus on the best of our community and the best of the men and women that served here and served across our community. Because as I told them earlier today, we will never know how many lives they saved. We will know the number of people who perished. And every death is one death too many. But we will never, ever be able to count the number of people who were saved because of the efforts that were done here, the efforts that were done in the field, the efforts that were done in the worst conditions imaginable when you couldn't see more than this far in front of your face. I've gone through a lot as county executive. We've had snowstorms, we've had COVID, we've had the mass shooting, we've had all kinds of bad things. And each time I try to take lessons from what happened and apply them in the future. And I think it's been, as a result, we've been able to respond better. We've been able to open better, open quicker in our community. But the one thing I will never forget, and I will always cherish, is the relationships I've been able to build with the men and women here and across our community. when it was so difficult, whether it was a Zoom call or I was talking face-to-face and we were dealing with horrific issues and having to make difficult decisions, these people are the best of who we are. They represent the best of Buffalo, the best of Erie County, the best of New York State, because there's people that came from all over. And it has been the honor of my life to work alongside them, even if I served in one small role, because they saved lives. They made a difference. And as a result, we can move forward, hopefully, as a stronger community. With that, we're going to open it up to questions. If you have a question, please raise your hand. Because there's so many, we are going to have it controlled off-site so that you can be unmuted by our board. We're going to start with the Buffalo News and Aaron Besseker. Aaron, you wait for them to unmute your phone. Let me make sure I got my volume up here. And then...
Hey, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you, Aaron. Go ahead.
All right, thanks for taking my question. I just wanted to clarify, earlier when you were doing the breakdown of the fatalities, I believe you said all seven suburban deaths were in Cheektowaga.
No. Did I say that? That's wrong. Okay. The seven suburban deaths were, I wrote down Cheektowaga, and that's why I probably just read it that way. Seven deaths were a combination of Amherst, Williamsville, Cheektowaga, and Depew, with Williamsville being primarily in Amherst as the village. So that has not increased or changed in the last few days. There are seven deaths, a combination of Amherst, the towns of Amherst and the town and Cheektowaga, and the villages of Williamsville and the village of Depew.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome. We will go down to, I don't have my glasses, Jeff Preval from Channel 4. Should I do it with my glasses?
County Executive, can you hear me?
I can. You can just speak a little louder, Jeffrey.
Sure. Could you just clarify the situation here with the bills? You had indicated the other day that the team had requested a police escort, but then was denied one from their trip from Rochester. Can you clarify, because the bills are now saying that they never requested an escort. Could you just...
Well, I will say this: they never requested one of me. I was informed that they were, but they never requested one from me. So I should have probably said yesterday they never requested one from me. I was told that it was, but I can't speak to that. If the person actually who told me that is not here, I just want to know. I know it's a big thing in people's minds, but right now we need to focus on recovery. We need to focus on helping these people grieve. When we think about what we went through as a community and helping those families grieve after the May 14th shooting, which was just the worst thing possible, and we're going to have double that, triple that number of deaths probably when all is said and done, and some of those families don't even know their loved one is dead yet. So I know that a lot of people want to focus on those issues, but we need to focus on recovery. We need to help these families grieve so that we can, as a community, come together. Tim Wenger, WBEN. I think it's Tim.
Yes, it is. Thank you very much, Mark. You said a lot yesterday, and you've apologized for it today. You know, you mentioned that the city wasn't present at the op center, and today you said they were. Can you just clarify, you've apologized, but what your intent was? What do you, you know, are there things you intend to follow up on and do based on what you said?
Tim, I believe that the mayor and I will have a conversation and we'll go into greater detail about a lot of those issues that I just brought up. But I did want to apologize to the community because the focus needs to be on, and I wanted to apologize to the men and women of the Department of Public Works for the City of Buffalo who have been working their butts off in just terrible conditions. But I want people to understand that our focus is on recovery and moving forward. And the conversations I have with the mayor will be conversations between us, and we'll go from there. You know, there's plenty of time for Monday morning quarterbacking. I shouldn't have done it. Simple as that. There's plenty of time for these discussions in the future. Right now, we need to focus on moving forward. And we can always be critical of others, and I was critical. I need to be critical of myself for what I did yesterday. It was just wrong. It was inappropriate. And we will go forward, and hopefully, as a result of this, provide a better overall response as a community. We stand ready, and I look forward to discussing this with the mayor. Spectrum News One Buffalo.
Hello. So you mentioned that data is being collected from those calling the snow line so that guards don't need to go to their home for a check. Is there something that people who didn't have power should do to report that they're okay in order to allow National Guard to maybe focus on the homes that have a more urgent need?
Well, anybody who contacted the 858 snow number will be contacted back. If you just lost power, you lost power for a shorter period of time, they're not going out to those homes. They're going to the worst areas that received, truthfully, had power lost even through yesterday, because power was not fully restored until basically last night. So I know they had done hundreds and hundreds of calls yesterday. They're back out there. I would not suggest calling because we'll get flooded. If we get flooded, every person who had a power outage called us, we'd never be able to handle all those calls because there at one time there was more than 20,000 customers in Erie County that were without power for an extended period of at least one day, two or three days, around 20, and we'd never be able to handle that flow. So. They are doing the welfare checks. They have been doing welfare checks. So the sheriff's office and others, the Buffalo PD, the EMS, they are doing welfare checks. But just because your power went out, please call. We are calling those that we felt were in the most, we're calling everyone back that called 858 snow to make certain that they're okay, whether they were in a car, whether they were out of food. We want to just make certain that everyone's okay. If you were without power, the National Grid for the National Guard is doing that check. Kristen Moran.
Hi there. I'm curious. So we have some people reaching out to us saying that they couldn't get into work, you know, because of the storm or due to the storm, they still can't get into work. Because of that, they're not getting paid. Is there anything you guys have discussed or plan to discuss with either the State Department of Labor, Governor's Office regarding helping people with payments that they missed out? Or does this really just come down to the employer and the employee?
It is, unfortunately, an employer-employee issue. When FEMA does reimbursement, and we're going to seek reimbursement for the governments, it is only for the governmental response. It is not for private damage. It is not for private loss. I'll turn it over to our Commissioner of Homeland Security Emergency Services, Dan Neverth, who can talk a little bit more about it. But I feel sorry for those who've lost wages, lost the money that they probably needed more than ever at the holiday season. But unfortunately, the county, nor the state, nor the federal government reimburses for private sector and personal loss.
Yeah, as we try and reclaim at least the public assistance, unfortunately, this was not a snowfall of record. So as the county executive and other elected officials have said, this is going to require teamwork and a full court press to change some of the rules that FEMA currently has, which essentially they say no dough for snow. Now the record, the snowfall of record was just about 5 weeks ago here in Western New York. So the snowfall of record, despite all of the tragedy and all of the additional costs that have been incurred, as well as all of the damages that we've yet to get out on the public side of things, to take a look at schools, roofs, everything else, buildings that might have been destroyed. Despite that, the fact that it falls 6, 7, or 8 inches short of the previous record should not be a disqualifier. So we're working that in addition to all of the things that are going on here, we're working that angle as well with our elected officials. Hopefully that will be changed. But as far as individuals, that unfortunately at this point, the Department of Labor might want to weigh in on that. But certainly at this point, that is between your business as well as, you know, between you and your business. So there's no avenue on that at this point. We'll look into it. We'll push those complaints if they're filed, but at this point, there's really not a whole lot that we can do.
Thank you, Dan. We'll take two more questions. Those are the only two I have, and we have to go. Kevin Nyas, you'll be unmuted.
Yes, Kevin Nyas with NBC News. We spoke to a resident who says on Friday, the fire department came by his mother's home, and his mother, she relies on limited mobility oxygen supply, and her power was out. However, the fire department told her that they could not take her with her. We were wondering, you know, why is the county not prepared in situations like this to transport people who have limited mobility issues like this woman?
Well, Kevin, I can't speak of this particular situation other than to note the county does not actually run any fire department. I don't know if this is a Buffalo Fire Department. I don't know if this is a volunteer fire department outside of the city and the towns. There are full-time...
Yes, this was in the city of Buffalo.
Okay, well, I guess I would direct that question to the Buffalo Fire. I can't answer that question. We have our Homeland Security Emergency Services Department. They're the trainers for firefighters. They help get them equipment through grants and things like that, but the actual fire departments are run by independent agencies. So if it did occur in the city of Buffalo, then I just ask you to direct your question to the city of Buffalo Fire Department, which I believe you'd have to go through the mayor's office on. A final question is to Kelly Holland. Kelly, Fox 29.
Hey, Mark. Just wanted to touch base on financials. Once in a generation storms, November, December, I'm guessing millions of dollars for each federal reimbursement coming, but how long will that take? And how does this impact county finances budget until that funding is received from the federal government?
Well, if it's received, which is a thing that we're going to be working, and I've already spoken on this storm to Senator Schumer and Senator Gillibrand, Congressman Higgins. We're hopeful that we will get reimbursement for our costs associated with the storm. We saw the federal declaration was made, but FEMA can be a little stickler at times. That's why we're asking for every community to dot their I's and cross their T's on the paperwork that's needed. I know that we've expended $5 million alone on independent contractors just for this storm. Basically, independent contractors since last Friday. And there were a couple days in which, of course, we didn't have anybody on the street. So we're $1 million a day, including $1 million yesterday to open up the southern part of Buffalo. The one thing I will note is we've been very good stewards of the public's finances. We were trending for a significant surplus even before the November storm that hit the South Towns. And regardless of what the expense is between now and just the end of this year, we will have significant reserves from this year alone to cover it. So even if we didn't get FEMA reimbursement, we will still end up with a surplus this year. And so there's accounting methods that are put in place to ensure that money is like, we have when I was the county controllers, people know that the money that's spent between now and the rest of the year is 2022. The money that we spend in 2023, we actually can apply back to this event because it's 2022, so we can use our surplus that has risen throughout this year to cover the costs. I can guarantee the people of Erie County that not only will we end this year with a surplus, this will not have a negative ramification on our bottom line. It's important, but when you think about the grand scheme of things, it's the least important thing. The most important thing is our community moving forward and helping those 39 families that we're aware of, with unfortunately more that'll probably be coming, get through this tragic situation of losing a loved one. But we're fine on the finances. I've got a great team led by Budget Director Robert Keating in the budget office and others who've just done incredible work. And they've been working behind the scenes in other areas as well throughout this whole storm. So thank you to Budget Director Keating and his team for the great work they've done, so that even though we've had these two tremendous storms that have required us to expend millions and millions of unanticipated dollars, we're going to be fine going forward. With that, this will end the news briefing for today. We are, as I said, beginning to demobilize the Emergency Operations Center. I have so much great respect for the men and women in this building. They are the true heroes, along with everyone else in the field who've done a tremendous work. So we are not planning on having another media briefing with regards to the storm. This will probably be my last day at the EOC, as I'll be back tomorrow at the Rath Building downtown, as county government offices are now open and my staff is out. Most of it is returned back downtown. So to everyone out there, thank you for all that you did to get us through this once in a generation, as they say. Hopefully it's once that we never see again. Storm, blizzard, the blizzard of 2022. And I really, really hope that we all have the best new year possible, and that 2023 brings us much joy and happiness after a very, very, very difficult 2022. be safe and well to all.
The city itself, and it is devastating. It is going to a war zone, and the vehicles along the sides of the roads are shocking. It's not just small vehicles. It is literally snow plows. It is major size recovery vehicles and utility vehicles and tow trucks. So we have a real challenge right now where we have roads blocked. Roads are literally blocked by emergency vehicles, so that has made it extremely challenging for us. We know it's Christmas, and I do want to comment on the fact that while wishing everyone a Merry Christmas, we are so grateful for the literally hundreds of people sacrificing their time away from family and loved ones to be out there making all of us safe, whether it's safe in our homes or safe in our streets. And I want to give a special shout out to the hundreds and hundreds of plow drivers who are out there literally rescuing people as we speak, and to our state police, who've been involved in over 500 rescues, literally helping everybody to getting elderly people to hospitals, helping a gentleman who only had 4% left on his mechanical heart. They got him the help he needed, and delivering a baby. So they have been out there. I am grateful for them on this Christmas holiday for all. We've talked about the scale of this storm. Those people of my age talk often about the Blizzard of 77. That was always the reference. Well, it's not as bad as the Blizzard of 7. Today I'm here to say that is now in the history books. We have surpassed the scale of that storm in its intensity, the longevity, the ferocity of the winds. So we now have what will be talked about not just today but for generations, the Blizzard of 22. Now that is not a source of problem. As Buffaloans, we know how to get through it, but we're still in the throes of this very dangerous, life-threatening situation. Just because people might see the sky a little bit today, those storms, the wind, the velocity, the volume, it's coming back, and it's going to come back tonight. So the number one message I want reinforced by the people with me here today, including Steve Nigrelli, the superintendent of New York State Police, is that you need to stay off the roads. We've been begging, we've been